because he's a God of purpose, he has a reason, he has a purpose for making it possible. He's not a God that is confused. He's not a God that says, okay, oh, I've taken this step, so I don't want to take it again, let me just change my mind. No, he has a purpose, he has a reason for allowing us to be alive to see this day. So let's give him praise for that. And just thank you once again for the bottom of our hearts. Let's exalt him. Exalt his name. Exalt his holy name. Magnify his holy name. Give him thanks. Because he has decided to march you forward this month of March. To another level of glory. To another realm of blessing. To another realm of favor. To another dimension of unimaginable breakthrough. Just give him thanks. Give him thanks. Give him thanks. Bless his holy name. Hallelujah to Jesus. I want us to pray. The Lord speak to me today. By your word, speak to me. Send your word. The word that will change my life. The word that will take me to another realm. Lord, send it to me in the mighty name of Jesus. I want us to pray for ourselves right now. That we have encounter with the word. That we will not just be the hearer of the word, but the doer. Because this is a kingdom that is governed by covenants. And until you play your role, God is not committed to play his role. The Bible says that, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him, until you believe in him, you cannot enjoy that benefit. Hallelujah to Jesus. Amen. So there is a need for us to take step in line with the covenant. That's why I want us to pray after that. Lord, grant me the grace to be the doer of your word. Grant me the grace to be the doer of your word. To be the doer of your word. Grant me the grace, Lord. Let us pray from the bottom of our heart with intensity. Lord, grant me the grace. Grant me the grace. Grant me the grace. Grant me the grace to be the doer of your word. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be your name, Lord. In Jesus' most precious name, we can pray.
Amen.
And dear Lord Jesus, we pray that by your Spirit, you will reveal unto us wondrous things, wonderful things out of your love today in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That none of us will remain the same after this encounter in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Cause your light to shine upon us in the mighty name of Jesus
Christ. Amen.
The appropriate word, the sent word, the word for the season, let it come expressly to us in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Let's put our hands together for Jesus. For Jesus. For the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As we have heard, the prophetic focus for the month is, let's cross it together, everybody.
Prosperity is God's plan for me in Christ Jesus.
Amen. Say with conviction. Prosperity is God's plan for me in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The subject of prosperity is a very important subject. And I want us to pay particular attention to whatever the Spirit of God is going to be speaking to us today. This subject is so important that Jesus did not say that you cannot serve God and the devil. He said you cannot serve God and mammon. He did not try to compare, or he did not try to say that something else is trying to compete for our heart, or something else is trying to fight for a place in our heart, or trying to compete with God for a place in our heart. But he said money, and not just money. We are talking about money personified. If you look at that word translated mammon here, it talks about money that has turned to, that has been personified, that has turned to something else. If you look at all the wars, right from World War I or World War whatever, if you dig deep, the reason behind that war is nothing but for the sake of money. We have seen situations where even parents ended up selling their children for the sake of money. We have seen instances where presidents of nations giving up the money that belongs to all the people. We have seen situations that even in the kingdom, some people have said, okay, oh, no, let me just join this group, or let me just go into the ministry, let me become a pastor for the sake of money. Judas Iscariot decided to join the group. You know, the Bible said that they knew from the beginning that he was a thief. Hello? He's been stealing from the camp because he was the treasurer, or the one that was keeping in charge of the treasury. And from time to time, whenever they ask him, say, okay, go take this bulk of money, go and give it to the needy. He will go to one corner, put some in his pocket, and say, hey, opportunity has come home. Let me go ahead and enjoy my life. So, both in and out of the kingdom, money is a very special thing. And at different times, people have reacted differently. Like we said when we were reading the prophetic focus. Some will say, okay, because of that, let me avoid even dealing with it. But can you really avoid dealing with money? You are an hypocrite. You are trying that. Because you won't go to Ika and go and pick maybe a bottle of oil or something. And when you are going, you say, okay, oh, because I'm a Christian. You pass through the thing. The alarm will sound. And what you know what is happening, the security man will grab you and say, okay, why did you do that? Oh, because I'm a Christian. No, they will arrest you. Hello? So you cannot say, okay, I don't want to deal with money. You cannot say, okay, I don't want to have anything to do with money. No. It's not possible. You cannot live here on this planet, on this side of the world, without the use of money. Thank you, Jesus. And like we have always said, the devil does not have the capacity to create anything. He doesn't have the creative power that God gave us. What he can only do is to pervert or to twist what has already been created. And just like his custom is, whatever he touches, we start to stink because it's a stinking spirit. The devil is a foul spirit. There is no amount of washing that you can do to anything that the devil touches. It will pervert it. Let me give you a very simple example. How many of us know what it calls Valentine's Day? It was just last month. Hello? But have you ever taken time to study the origin of it? It's actually Saint Valentine's Day, not Valentine's Day. People now see it as a day to go out and is it. The only thing they remember about it is just to go out on a date. Sharing flowers. It wasn't about that. It was about celebration of the love of God. It was a time that was set aside to celebrate somebody who believed in Jesus. They said that when the emperor said, do not preach this gospel anymore. Do not do this, do not do that. Even when they said that, he said that the Romans, army or Roman soldiers laughed that they should not get married. And this man said, no, I can't see it in the scripture. And he decided to go ahead and do what was right according to the scripture, and he was killed, was beheaded for that sake. And the next said, okay, let's set aside a day to celebrate the man that lived his life also for the gospel. But when the devil hijacked it, he turned into something else. Hello? So Valentine, you know, like my family was saying that day, okay, Valentine. I said, yes, Valentine is about going out to work for outreach, for witness. So the day to share flowers for what? There's nothing wrong in sharing flowers. It's a day to tell people that there is no any other name that can save you. There is no any other name through which any man can be saved apart from the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So, like I'm saying, whatsoever the devil touches, it will stink. The devil knows that you cannot live without the issue of prosperity. You cannot live, you cannot succeed without money. And then also, he tried to grab it, to abuse it. But money itself is not evil. The Bible said, the law love of money is the root of all evil. He didn't say money itself is the root. Hello? So the appropriate thing to do is to put it where it belongs, or to look at it from the eye of God, or from the perspective of God, not from the perspective of man. Thank you, Jesus, right? Let's look at the scripture in Luke chapter 16. Thank you, Jesus. Luke 16, starting from 8 to verse 13. He said, "And the Lord commanded the unjust steward, because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wiser than the children of light." Now, what Jesus speaking, he said, "And I say unto you, make to yourself friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when ye pray, they may receive you into everlasting habitation." No, Jesus, they're trying to compare the world system now with the kingdom system. That even the world system, they are so smart that they try to fortify themselves, or they prepare for the time of challenges. And if you know, if you see the way the world system operates, in quotes, they love themselves. If you see a drunkard, if he doesn't have money, if he goes to the pub, he will get free beer to drink. Hello? He won't have to beg to swear before they give him. But see a believer in need. The believer, the other people will say, "Okay, the Lord bless you. He won't do anything. He won't lift a finger to help him." And so in verse 10 he said, "He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. And he that is unjust in the least is unjust also in the much. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches?" Jesus said, if you are unfaithful with the money in the wrong, out of the kingdom, there is no one. God will not commit unto you the true riches, which means there is true riches. Hello? Just like we have faith, prosperity. We have true prosperity. He said, who will give you the true riches? He said, and if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? Verse 13 said, no servant can serve two masters. The word master there is the word Lord. No servant can serve two lords. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold on to one and despise the other. You cannot, he didn't say you may not. He said you cannot. You don't have the capacity to serve God and mammon at the same time. So he was trying to tell them that the issue of money is so important that whatever your action, your word, your thought, or anything is either motivated because of the love of God for service for God or service for money. All the kingdom has been built on this health. All the ism, capitalism, socialism, whatever ism they call it, it's all about money, sir. It's all about money. They will try to paint it in every other name and try to cajole people. It is all about money. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
People measure the standard or the level or the status of other people because of it. Using money as a standard. Why did they talk about the third world today? It's not because of money. It's because of money. Hello? Not because of language. Not because of height. Not because of the size of their bodies. Even of the money. Look at the people that have say or who are respected in UN today. It's because they contribute more to the cause. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And if you cut it down, even to the family level, people who are respected in society are people who can say, okay, what is the issue? Okay, I'm writing check to cover it. So it's not something that you can ignore. You ignore it at your own peril. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. There has been many things going on, and especially in this world of technology and information that we are living in. You know, know, a lot of messages coming through WhatsApp, on Viber, and all the, through the media. A lot. And this is a time when we need to really get connected or set a lot there to know the truth. Because Bible says you shall know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Bible said that even in the end time, the elect will be deceived. Why? Because the elect are not equipped with the truth. People will say all manner of things, talk about all manner of things. And by the time you look through the eye of the Holy Spirit, you will see that this message sounds strong, sounds wonderful, but it's not in line with the scripture. And so you have to know the will of God concerning every issue of your life, so that you will not be deceived. You will not be deceived in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. There has been a lot of time when people send messages condemning prosperity message, for example. And anytime I look and I see things like that, I just laugh. Because it's not godly, sir. God is not a confused God. God will not call the Jehovah Jireh and at the same time say that you should not preach prosperity. No. What is wrong is that when you preach faith prosperity, when you talk about prosperity outside the kingdom, or prosperity that is not true, or prosperity that is not according to the will of God, then we should not preach that. But that does not mean that we should not preach prosperity, because without preaching it, people cannot prosper in God's way. Hallelujah to Jesus. In Galatians chapter 3, let's read it. Hallelujah to Jesus. Starting from 13. 14. Hallelujah. Are you getting anything from this? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Galatians 3. Hallelujah. The cross is here, everyone are hanging on the tree, that the blessing of Abraham may be upon the Gentiles. Are you there? He said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law. You remember when we're reading the Bible passage for the day, we read Deuteronomy chapter 28. Deuteronomy 28 from 1 to 14 talks about blessing. And it can be summarized in everything it's about breakthrough and prosperity and good health. Or what we can call shalom, which means nothing broken, nothing missing. Health and wealth. Hallelujah. From 1 to 14, that is it. But downward from 15 down to the last, it talks about poverty. So, poverty is a curse, it's not a blessing in disguise. Don't let any devil, your people are so passionate, like I've only been telling us, for people are passionate about the wrong thing. Sincerity does not equal to reality. You can be sincerely wrong. You can be passionately wrong. You can be passionate about something. You know, people that are going around blowing themselves because of religious cause, they are passionate about it. But are they right? No! You won't go to heaven by blowing yourself because you want somebody to become a Muslim. No, you go to hell. But they are passionate about it. They are doing it. In fact, they are crying. They are weeping. That was why Paul said that one thing I know, according to the book of Romans, he said the Israelites, they have a kind of zeal, but that zeal was not according to knowledge of the truth. They think they are serving God. They are even passionate, but they are weeping. But they are not doing it according to the law of God. Some people are even busy attacking prosperity message, thinking they are doing God's service. But they are not doing it according to the will of God. Because look at it. He said, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made curse for us. Why? For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Verse 14. Why did he hang on a tree? He said that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. Blessing of what?
Abraham.
Was Abraham begging? No. Was he going to the neighbor and saying, please, can I get something on there? No. That was not his plan. God planned for him. He said that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through what?
Through faith.
He said the blessing of Abraham will come unto us through Christ Jesus. And by what? By faith. And if you go to Romans, hallelujah.
Amen.
How will the prosperity come to us? Through what? Through faith. The prosperity or the blessing of Abraham will come. mammon through faith. Now, Romans 10. Romans chapter 10. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Romans 10, 7. Let's start from 17. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Maybe I'm damaging your philosophy. I'm moving on by the word of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So that's the word of God is a hammer.
Yes.
It breaks every stronghold. Every satanic hold that has been abiding on you in your heart. The word of God will break it down within the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Romans 10, 17. He said, are we there?
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah. He said now. No, I mean Acts. Sorry.
Acts.
No, it's supposed to be Romans.
But I'm just in my Bible. I open Acts.
He said, so then. Faith comes by what?
By hearing.
Faith comes by what?
By hearing.
Faith comes by what?
By hearing.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Now, verse 18 said, but I say, have ye not heard? Yes, verily, their son went into all the earth, and there was unto the ends of the earth. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, if you come back a little, let's start from 14. He said, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? Heard mean information. And how shall they hear without a preacher? It's not possible. Hello? It's not possible. He said, they cannot hear except somebody preaching. Everyone talks about it. Hello? He said, how then shall they call on God? If nobody has preached to you about God, how can you call on God? You cannot call a God that you don't know exists. Hello? See, don't spiritualize this thing. Make it very simple, sir. You cannot call on God that you don't know exists. And he said that how can you call on God until you are informed about that God? Hello? And he said, and how shall they believe on him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Hello? He said, and how shall they preach except they have been sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Now, verse 16 said, but they have not obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah said, Lord, who has believed our report? Now, verse 19 together. So then, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Remember, in Galatians 3:13 and 14, he said, the blessing of Abraham will come upon you by faith. And that faith comes by hearing. And that hearing comes by preaching. So when you don't preach prosperity, people will not hear about the true prosperity. When they don't hear about the true prosperity, they will not become rich in God's way. So when you see the devil trying to say they should not preach prosperity, he simply wants to keep people poor or make them to live in to believe in fake prosperity. Because fake prosperity is when people go to steal from government or from any sector. I know that this one belongs to me. It will be absolute insanity for me to go and be stealing it. How can I even feel? It's already with me. So if you see a man stealing from government or stealing from somewhere, it's because of lack of confidence in the fact that it belongs to him already. In Christ Jesus, you have been, purchased, you have been redeemed from poverty already. So if you are stealing, either because something is wrong with your head or you are ignorant of that reality, sir. Hello? That's why I said faith comes. So we need to preach it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need to preach it because there is no any other way to get rid of poverty or get rid of corruption apart from the word of God. You know, you can You can lose it, CIA of every state of every country, the police and the army, everybody. They don't have the capacity to deal with corruption. Do you think somebody will stop being a corrupt person because you lock him in jail? No! That's why that you see when they capture people and put them in jail, how many of them have returned to become better in reality? No! You just lock him. You incapacitate him physically. Once he gets opportunity, he won't go and steal again. Hello? I met one guy in South Africa. I was caught in the shop. He stole chocolate. You know, he stole all his bars with chocolate. And this guy, I was even pitying him. He said, pity. You know what he said? He said, I don't mind them. Once they bail me, I'm going to the next shop right. He's going to steal again. He said, why? He said, they offended him. So he has bought at every shop right and he goes, he will steal their chocolate. That's crazy, man. Hallelujah. So you can put him in jail. You don't need to stop him. How many of government officials in nations have been put in jail? Did he stop corruption? No. He doesn't have it. He can't wait to stop it. The only thing that can stop it is the power of God. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
It takes the power of God to deal with corruption and worship of mammon. There is no policy, human policy that you can put into place that can handle that. Thank you, Jesus. Look at this in Romans 7:19. Paul was lamenting. Paul at this time was not an unbeliever. Was an apostle of the land. Loaded with the spirit. Anointed with the power. He's been going from nation to nation, from city to city, preaching the gospel. Look at what he said in Romans 7:19. He said, for the good that I will do, I do not. But the evil which I will do, that I do. That I will not, that I do. Did you get it? Paul was saying that the good thing that I know that I'm supposed to do, I find it difficult to do it. It is nothing that I don't want to do that I'm doing. And he went further in the same Romans 7:24-25, he said, oh wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Now, he said, verse 25, he said, I thank God. Say, I thank God.
I thank God.
I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the Lord of God, law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin. Do you know that God didn't give them the law so that they can obey it? Because he knew they didn't have the capacity to obey it, sir. The law was given to them to show them their weaknesses, to say, to cry unto God, say, oh God, I have tried to obey this law, I couldn't. What did I miss? God said, I didn't empower you. Forget about the justice, forget about tithing. My wife asked me the other day, she said, is it possible for some people to be preaching something and not living by it? I said, yes. It's possible. It's not about tithing. There are preachers that talk about tithing, who don't pay tithing. There are preachers that are stealing people's money. Hello? They're not accountable. Hello? Some, almost they finish service, like one of our fathers said, he went to minister somewhere when they just started ministry. And they finished the service. On the way home, the preacher went to buy bread. He just dipped money into the offering that they collected that was in his car. And he looked and said, offering that they just collected. They are buying bread. That bread was not given for the church, for his home. He's a pastor. Buying bread for the offering. If not, you can't tell me. You can't tell me. What is this? So it's not by title. Hallelujah. It's not by title. In 2 Corinthians 10, 6 and 10, 3. 2 Corinthians 10, 3. He said, for though we walk in the flesh, we do not walk after the flesh. Because for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or are not physical. You cannot shoot down an ideology by gun. No. Can you? No. You can kill a man. But that doesn't mean that you have stopped him from believing what he has believed. Hello? You can beat a man. You can beat a child.
stop him from believing what he has believed. No, it is not your gain that will correct him, sir. No. It's a choice that you make, out of a quality decision that you make. That's why I want to think this way. In fact, that's what repentance is, to change your mind. To change your mind and your way. So when I say repent, it means change your mind, change your way of thinking so that you can change your way. Because if you hear wrongly, you will believe wrongly. And when you believe wrongly, you will act wrongly. When you act wrongly, you will end up in the wrong destination. That is why when you don't hear the truth concerning prosperity, you will believe wrongly. Thank you, Jesus Christ. So he said, the weapon of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty, through God, to the pulling down of stronghold. Stronghold of what? You know, when people are praying, they think no stronghold are just small demons. No, that's not. Stronghold talks about the belief system, the ungodly way of thinking. That's the stronghold. Hello? Stronghold are not those small demons that you are casting out. No! It's your way of reasoning. Look at it this way. He made it clear. He said, casting down imagination. What is imagination? Image formation. You know, we take a picture. Hello? We take a picture. When I say cat, you see the word C-A-T. Hello? When I mention the word cat, immediately the picture of cat appears in your mind, isn't it?
Yeah.
When I say pray, do you see T-R-A-I-N? No! The picture of pray comes in your face. Victor, is it true? You never look at it that way. When you say Uskur, you see H-O-P, whatever. No! Your mind goes home instantly. Because we take in picture.
Hallelujah to Jesus.
That's why he said, bringing down imagination. Imagination means picture that you have formed in your mind concerning a thing. Or your mental picture of the actual future or that you are thinking about. He said now, casting down or shooting down imagination and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, bringing into captivity every word.
Every thought.
So we are talking about fighting the good fight of faith. We are talking about bringing down the ungodly way of reasoning. Because if a man, I was listening to a video clip recently, about the World Economic Summit. And one of the main things that featured there was the issue of Nigeria. They were talking about the corruption, the high level of corruption that they said that about 50 people, they stole how many billions? You see? But then when people are still shouting and saying, no, did he stop it? No! Because the one that is shouting too, by the time he gets there, give me 3 months. He has told you that more than what the same guy that's completely lost is doing. So it's more than just physical. There is this mindset that has to be dealt with satanically in this mindset. We are trying to invade Nigeria with the youth ministry. And I said, okay, before we even present it to the church here, let them go and do underground work. They went to the university to talk to some heads of fellowship. And they tell them, okay, this is what we want to do. We want to come and preach the gospel. We want to, set up people who we call mentors that will mentor you to greater height. I said, oh, that's a very good thing. Where did that preacher? Where is that preacher coming from? Is that from abroad? Good. Then, apart from that, what they do is there to gain. I said, they need to listen. They are going to pray for you. They are going to preach the word of God to you. They are going to even connect you with mentors that will give you information on how to get there. I said, no, we're not talking about that. What about the money? Money. That is every thought that is exalting itself against the knowledge of God. Because what will make you to get money is what you want to give you. If you give money, you will spend it, And that's why people will go on the day of election. They will give them 500 naira and they will vote and save their destiny because of that imagination. Because he believes that if I can get this one now, yes, at least today is settled. What of tomorrow? Casting down that kind of thought that said, no, I will not save my destiny for a morsel of bread. No, I would rather die than take bread. Thank you, Jesus Christ. He said, casting down everything, high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God and bring it to captivity. So captivity means prison. Imprison those ungodly thoughts that say that you cannot make it until you steal. That is satanic. That is foul. That is from the devil. He wants to take you to hell. You won't go to hell in the name of Jesus Christ. Because hell is real, sir. Hell is real. You don't need to steal to make it in life. Prosperity has been paid for. Fully paid for by Jesus. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter 5, it talks about that the Lamb of God that was slain to receive for us power. The next one is riches. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. But what we are trying to talk about is that the issue of faith, of prosperity, is God's plan for us. It is real, but we need to straighten up to think in line with the word of God so that we will have money. Money will not have us. But money can have you. When money becomes your master, when it becomes your Lord, it means that as you find the word considered Lord or master means a mighty owner. So when money is controlling you, when money has become the motive for why you do a thing or you take a step, the money has become your master or your Lord. It's one that has owned you. May you be set free forever in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Yeah. Because those who run after money, we can never make money. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. He said, all these things shall be added. It's an addition. Not something you have to beg for, sir. No. The psalmist says, I was young. Now I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. It's not possible. It's not possible. It is not possible. Hello? It is not the geographical location. That's how people miss it. Are there no beggars in America? Are there no beggars in Stockholm? Are there no beggars in the so-called prosperous country? Hello? Thank you, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The Bible said, the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. So that is Hebrew 4:12. He said, the word of God is quick and is powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joint and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts. See, thoughts come back now. Remember, bringing down strongholds. And those strongholds are thoughts. The same way, when the Bible was talking about the power of the word of God, he said he has the ability to what? He's a discerner of the thought and the intent of the heart. That's what you are thinking. Because somebody can give without loving, but you cannot love and not give. Somebody can say, because I want to marry this girl, I like his look, and start spending on her. And once he brings him in or brings her in, he will start maltreating her. The giving was not motivated by love. Hello? But the word of God is able to what? To discern or to expose or to show the intent of the heart. A pastor can be shouting and they are giving water. All his throat is in trouble. Why? He wants the church to be full so he can get more money. Hello? He may not even be for money so he can go around and brag. Oh, I'm the pastor of the largest church in Stockholm. It's not easy. Are you passionate? Is your heart panting after God? In such a way that the church will be full because people are taken from the pit of hell to the kingdom and restored, or because you want to go around and brag that you are the pastor of the largest church here? Intent. 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 Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. Yeah. You can run after people and make call to them and say, oh, I'm calling them regularly just because you want them to help you. But are you calling them because of love? Because you are calling them because of love, if they didn't give you that thing you are calling them for, you won't be offended. Hallelujah to Jesus Christ. You won't be offended. You say, when this social pressure was having them, his daughter's birthday, I was there. I even took a day off. But when my son was having his birthday, he didn't show up. So I feel like he's a bad friend.
Did you go to his birthday before this happened because you love him or not? Or because of another intention? He said, discerner of the intents and the thoughts.
What am I trying to say? It is the word of God. Thank you, Jesus Christ. If you look at Ezekiel 36, thank you, Jesus. Are you getting anything from this? Ezekiel 36. We won't read everything because of our time. But in Ezekiel 36, the Bible was talking about the children of Israel. You are full of evil. Doing all manner of wrong things in Ezekiel 36, verse 22. Hallelujah. He said, therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus said the Lord God, I do not this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the heathen, whither ye went. So when they went into the heathen or into captivity because they sinned. Hello? They opened themselves up for the enemy to capture them because they sinned. But even there, when they arrived at the country where they took them to, they didn't change. That's why God said that you have profaned my name among the living heathen where you went. Is it not happening? From people before he came to Sudan, every mountain in Nigeria and Africa, he went there to pray. Oh, give me Mr. Let Mr. come. He is here now. He doesn't go to church. There are people in Arab land. He's praying. Oh God, they are persecuting me. I'm a Christian. If I can get to a country where they are still not carrying this Bible, I will serve God. Is he going to church in that country? He go around with big necklace. What do you call that? A pendant of cross. But he's not carrying the cross of Jesus. He's not carrying a fake cross. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The promise you made that, Lord, if you deliver me, I will serve you with all my heart. Are you serving him? That was what you were doing. You were in the land of captivity. It didn't change. But how did God react? And God said in verse 23, he said, I will sanctify my grave. He said, for my name's sake, I will clean my name, which was profaned among the heathen, which you have profaned in the midst of them, and the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, said the Lord God. When I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes. Verse 24. He said, for I will take you from among the heathen. I will separate you. And I will gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. He said, then will I spring clean water upon you. Clean water is talking about the word of God. The water is the symbol of the word of God. He said, you are sanctified by the cleansing of the water, by the word. So he said, he will sprinkle his word over them. And what will the word do? He said, and ye shall be clean. He said, in John 17:17, he said, sanctify them by thy word, for thy word is truth. So he said, he will release his word into their midst. Who is the word? The word was in the beginning with God, and the word was God. And that word became flesh, and that word was Jesus Christ. So he said, I will release my word. I will release my only begotten son. He will go into your midst. He will die, and his blood will purify you. So you cannot get purified by your own habit or for your own power. It's not possible. He said, then we let him go with clean water. Now, verse 26, he said, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. So I will give you a kind of heart that responds to God. I will take that stony heart away. That means it takes the power of God to break the yoke of ungodliness. Hello? So forget about all the meetings of the UN. UN cannot handle corruption. The nations that are running, that are even judging others that they are corrupt, are they clean too? Are there no teeth in Sweden? Are there no teeth in the US? Are there no teeth in England? The money they are stealing from Africa, where are they keeping it? Is it not in their land? Are they not taking it? How many of the money that is in there? Remember when one of our president in Nigeria died and they said they stole a lot of money and put it in Sweden? And he said, In Switzerland. The money is in there now. They are still fighting legal battle to get the money released. Who is the real team? They are the same. Without the spirit of God, without the power of God working at work in you, forget about it. Holiness is impossible. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
It is impossible. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Lord.
Hallelujah. So he said, give them a new heart. As we quickly round up, Let's look at the proofs that prosperity is from God. Number one, if you're writing down, if you look at it from the garden, God put man that he created in a garden, not in a ghetto. Hello? He didn't say, okay, I therefore will create a ghetto and I will put him there. No, he put him in the garden. Hallelujah. Put him in the garden, not in the ghetto. Thank you, Jesus Christ. He put him in the garden. And the garden was a beautiful place. Genesis 1 and 6. So one of the reasons and one of the proof that prosperity is from God is not from the devil, is because God created man and he put him in a beautiful garden. Thank you, Jesus Christ. He put him in a garden, not in the ghetto. And brethren, let us understand this. What is even the definition of money? Hello? How many of us did economics? Maybe that. Did economics? Yeah. He said money is a means of the exchange, isn't it? See, you know, in the old time, if I want this microphone and I have a car, I have to tie my car and go through the street of Stockholm. And I have to look for somebody that has microphone and in need of car. Yeah, the country by butter. It was difficult. And later, as human environment kept on advancing, they said, now let's look for a better way. You know, it changed later. They started using gold, started using metal to exchange. And now we use paper. But there is no way you can sell your value without money. There's no way the kingdom of God can expand without money. There's no way you can even fulfill that mandate that God gave in Genesis 1:28 to be fruitful and multiply and replenish here without money. Hello? So, one of the proof that shows that prosperity is from God is because, one, God created a man and he put him in a garden, not in a ghetto. Genesis 1:26. Number two, all the friends of God in the Bible, they were rich. Mention the one. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hello? So God is not against riches. He's the Most High, yet. So if God will combine holiness and riches, and you are created in his image, you are created to enjoy affluence or prosperity as well. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Look at Abraham. Genesis 13:2. He said, Abraham was very rich. And Bible said, God is everyone that hanging on the tree, that the blessing of Abraham. Abraham who became the reference point. Was Abraham rich? Hello? Answer me. Was he rich? He was rich. Man, calculate it. Do you know how much it costs to buy a car right now? I say a car is really will not less than 5,000 minimum. Which is really just more than that, actually. Isn't it? And a cow should be more than that. So, if you have 1,000 cows, what's that 5,000? 5,000 cows than 1,000. Look at your lot. And you have thousands of people. What's it for? All the friends of God, Isaac, in Genesis 26, 24, said, then Isaac sold in the land and received in the same year. And hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him, not that the Lord caused him. And the man was great and went forward and grew until he became very great. Not just great, not just somehow great, but very great. For he had possession of flocks. The flocks. And possession of herds and great store of servants. And the Philistines envied him. You could see that a whole nation envied a man. Was he poor? Would they envy a poor man? They won't even listen to him. Hello? You know the story that Jesus told about Lazarus and the rich man. Hello? The rich man, when he was even in that terrible place, he was so used to the fact that poor people are supposed to be slaves and servants that he even said, okay, Abraham, please, can you send your boy to come and give me water? Because they don't respect a poor man. Poverty, there is nothing good in poverty. No! It's not God's plan for you, sir. He doesn't give you a voice. Hello? Hello?
Hi.
Man, let's speak Hebrew. He said, Abraham. He said, hello, my boy. He said, okay, he said, Shabbat, let me give you the water. He was even sending him around. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look at Jacob. Jacob, when he was coming back to meet his brother, do you know the amount of wealth that he even sent as gift? Genesis 26, 29. He sent gift. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
Jacob, in Genesis 32, 1, 13 to 18, you could see that he was a very, very rich man. Look at Job. Let's read that one. Job 1. Job chapter 1. He said, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was perfect and upright. Hallelujah. And one that feared God and eschewed evil. And there was born unto him seven sons. To take care of seven sons in any economy. This is. Hello? And three daughters. That's ten. His substance also was 7,000 sheep. Let's say they are selling a sheep for 2,000. Multiply it. You know, average people here, they can, if you say, something happened now, bring 10,000 in 2 months' time. And like, they have to be on a bone in my own dancing. Without paying him small. So where is the prosperity we are talking about? It's just man-made. When Abraham died, did he leave death for his children? Say, okay, my son, Isaac, when I die, make sure you pay this, you know. No. He left plenty. You will leave plenty for your children.
Amen.
You know some people, even in Sweden here, Sweden is regarded as one of the most prosperous nations to live today. But how many people succeed in paying their mortgage finish before they die? So who owned the house in reality? How many of them will the church say, okay, Papa, I mean, the daddy has died now. Let me go and have this our house. They have to continue paying. So where is the prosperity? Hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Lord. So Bible said he had 3,000 camels. 500 yoke of oxen. You know what's called yoke of oxen? You know when you put thank you, Jesus. He said, and when they were come into the house, they saw a young child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him. What did they present?
Gift
of what?
Gold.
What is gold? In today's language. What is gold? Tell me. Tell me what is gold.
Black gold.
Money.
Money.
You think you put it like a wearing? You don't think about that with earring. Hallelujah. Like that we don't say bring earring for what? It is money. God, if money was evil, why would they be given the only begotten Son of God money? Money to do what? To live. Hallelujah.
Amen.
They gave him money. They gave him gold and frankincense. And mirror. Check it. That time. Very expensive. So God gave back to his only begotten Son and he put him into what? In the midst of prosperity. Number five. Jesus had enough for his ministry. Hallelujah. Jesus had enough for his ministry. If prosperity was wrong, Jesus would have been going around and begging, oh, please, we have not eaten. Give us something. No, let's calculate it in today's language. Remember, he had the 12 apostles that he employed before. Then he added 70. 12 plus 70. Calculate it. 92, is it?
82.
Now, in today's grammar, in today's standard, in Sweden, they don't have anything called minimum wage. But if you want to apply for residence permit and work permit, you need a minimum of 13,000. Multiply 13,000 times 82. That's in every month. Times 3 years. 3.5 years of his ministry. Can a poor man run a ministry that has full-blown staff, full-blown pastors, full-time workers, 82 workers. How many companies have 82 workers there? So when you see the picture of Jesus that they put together without shoes, going around like a man that is hungry, it's not true. But that's not the kind of Jesus. No. Remember when he was standing on the sea? He was standing on a convoy of sheep. Not one. It was so comfortable that the Bible said when he wanted to rest, he went down. He put his head on the pillow. That means that thing even had layers. Can a poor man afford that kind of boat to travel with? He will be hanging. You know, in Lagos, that moonway, he hang like this one leg. Oh, I want you to see this guy so that stronghold of poverty that is hanging on your mind, you will delete it today. Hello? You are in Christ Jesus. Riches belongs to you. It's not for the world. Jesus had love. The reference is Luke chapter 10, 1 to 2. Luke 10, 1 to 2. I mean, 1 and 2. He had enough. He was a prayer of labor. You know, he was so rich, crazy that Judas was stealing. And not even finished. You know, Judas was so aggressively stealing. The money didn't finish. He was able to pay them. But can the poor man do that? It's not possible. Where will he get it from? No. He wasn't poor. Hello? He wasn't poor. Thank you, Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
Let's look at the last one I mentioned before we close today. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number 6. The church in the wilderness was born in prosperous church. When they were to leave Egypt, did they leave begging? No. In fact, God told them, he said, go to your neighbors, go and get gold, go and get gift. They gave them gold again. So the early church left as a prosperous church. There was no need to say, there's hunger, what do we do? Let's go and get something. No. In fact, there was a time God fed them. He fed them with meat. Today, the Ram said it was coming out of their mouth, out of their nose. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That is, they had more than enough. Hello? You are not going to the pool and say, okay, let me look for this rat. No,
he was falling on them. Manna was falling on them. That's prosperity, sir. That was prosperity. They had enough food, they had enough meat, they had enough gold. In fact, when he wanted to invade the community, they were so scared. They said, hey, these people, if they come, they will lick us up as if we are compared to themselves as grass to the cow. Will you describe a poor man like that?
No.
He was not poor. Look at it even today. Israel, in that region, how many? There are just about 4 million people. We have the strongest economy. No single drop of oil. Good oil, technology, agriculture. In one of the driest countries in the world, they are one of the best in irrigation. Riches.
We don't have to put Matthew on Jesus, right?
Amen.
So, that's the reference is Exodus chapter 12, Exodus 12, 33 to 36. The church in the wilderness was not born as a poor church, but a prosperous church. Exodus chapter 12, verses 33 through to 36. And number 7. Hallelujah. The New Testament church was not also born as a poor church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
If you study the Bible very well, Bible history, in the old time, which type of people dwell in upper room, in story building? Is it poor people? I think when I was growing up, the people who live in story building in our area, they have all that money. Where will a poor man get story building from? In fact, the money to buy, to do the decking, when he hears the value, he will faint. Where would he get it from? And this guy was in upper room. Upper room, the Bible did not say they were lodged in a bush under a grass covering themselves. They were in upper room, sir. Not rented. That belonged to one of them. Is that poverty? No. You see, I want you, whenever you are reading the scripture, try to visualize it in today's reality. You will understand it better that way. So no devil will succeed in deceiving you and say, okay, you know,
things are not working.
Manage. It will be better. It will be better that way. Until you recover, whatever you don't resist, you cannot conquer.
Thank you, Jesus Christ. So the New Testament church was born in rich church. Acts chapter 4. 92-97. I like that one. That page very well. Let's read it. He said in Acts chapter 4, verses 32-37, he said, and the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own. But they had all things. They had what?
All things.
They had all things. Hello? Can a poor man be described as he had all things? No. He doesn't have all things. He can't sleep. Because by all, you know, Sweden, starting from on the 12th of the month, they will start bringing in the bill. So as the thing is dropping, the postman, that, you know that yellow car, as it's coming, and he's dropping this, he says, hey, this month has come again. He's in trouble because he doesn't have money to pay. If you have money to pay, will you be in trouble? You won't even open it. Honestly, you don't look at some of the beer, I don't even open at all until the day you will pay. Hello, sir.
As the Lord liveth, everything that is trying to eat up your career, God of heaven will fight for you in the mercy of Jesus Christ.
Amen. Your children and you will not end up as a beggar in the mercy of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Everybody could be in poverty, sir. Hallelujah. He said they had all things in common. He said, and with great power gave the apostle witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them all. Now, verse 34, he said, neither was there any among them that lacked. But, is this in the scripture? Is this in the Bible?
Yes.
He said they didn't lack. So the church when that was given back to them, that time they didn't lack. Why should the church lack now? Why should they have to fuse denomination A and denomination B together? Because they wouldn't pay the bills. That's what's happening in Sweden now. They say, oh, church A and church B, they couldn't pay the bills. You know, most pastors are now, before you can see a church that can hire a pastor full time in Sweden now, you can't count on it. Why would they get it? What happened to the church? That's not the church that Jesus died for. That was not the picture. No, that we have to fill the denomination A and denomination B before we're able to pay bills.
Oh. Hallelujah.
They didn't lack.
Thank you, Jesus. He said, where am I? He said, for as many as were possessors of land. Possessors of what? Of what? Land. They had landed property. Can a poor man have land? He knows where will he get it from. Even if he had it, he will sell it fast. Hallelujah. Possessors of lands, plural. And of what?
Houses.
Eh?
Houses.
Eh?
Houses.
Wow. They sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold. If you don't have house to sell, you sow seed into the kingdom. You know, if you are passing up offering from one seed to the other, can you give what you don't have?
No.
You can only give what you have. So how will you be able to sell house and give as a sacrifice if you don't have a house? When they call for altar service, that you raise altar of sacrifice and give your car, you give car that you don't have. They say you want to go and steal it. And if you steal to give to God, it's not acceptable. Hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's stand up. Hallelujah.
God's plan.
Prosperity. God's plan is prosperity. He said, they laid down, they sold their houses, they laid down the money down at the apostles' feet. And distribution was made unto every man according as he had need. Hello? According as he had need. So, if, according to their welfare plan, if this one comes, that's okay, his house rent costs 6,000 grand, okay, you need 6,000, the Lord bless you, brother, take it in Jesus' name, what is your name? Oh, I've not been able to pay my rent, to buy groceries for past 3 months. Okay, what do you need? Take this money, go and buy groceries. Their needs were being catered for by the offering. Can a poor man, a poor church do that? It's possible.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And like I said, and Joseph, who by the apostle was surnamed Barnabas, which is being interpreted son of consolation, a Levite, and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it and brought the money and laid it an apostle. So they even mentioned name of those who sold their houses. Yeah. And the last one, the eighth one, is without riches, life, vision, and even gospel cannot be preached. How will you preach it? And all this equipment that you are using. You're saying, you will shout to this and that, you will drink two buckets of water, I won't take your food. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. That's the truth. You say we're going to Bellingby and say we're going to be okay. If you ask everybody that's like, there's no money for Oscar, let's jump to Bellingby. Excuse me, Paul. Say, tomorrow I have an appointment. Don't let me come out. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But it's okay, we are going to Bellingby. There's no car for everybody to go. People will come. So there is nothing holy in poverty. The summary of the day today. There is nothing holy in poverty. Poverty is a curse. May you be liberated about the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Book of Zechariah chapter 1 and verse 19. He said, Cry yet, saying, thus said the Lord of hosts, my cities, true prosperity, shall yet be spread abroad. And the Lord shall yet comfort Zion, and shall yet choose Jerusalem. Through what? Prosperity. True poverty? No. Poverty again. God forbid. Hallelujah to Jesus. Yeah. Let's begin to give him praise. Let's give him thanks. Let's magnify his holy name. Let's thank him. He's worthy. He said, I wish above everything, above all things, that thou prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. He said, that is my plan for you. That is my wish for you. That is my agenda for you. That's my agenda for you. God is saying that it is not his plan for his church to be begging. It is not his plan for the church to be living from hand to mouth. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him thanks. Adore him. Appreciate him. Worship him. Exalt his holy name. Oh, we give you thanks. We give you thanks, Lord. We bless your holy name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be your name, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
You said, with dung, can you draw water out of the wells of salvation? And the wells of salvation contain what? Power and riches and other things mentioned. So, God wants us to dig it. To dig it out. I want us to pray right now that every hold of poverty in your lineage must give with the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let us pray that by the blood of Jesus, every hold of poverty must expire today, because we are in Christ Jesus. Because we are in Christ Jesus. Every hold of poverty must end in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. By the blood of Jesus Christ, every form of limitation, every form of limitation must be removed by the blood of Jesus. Every form of limitation must be removed by the blood of Jesus. Every form of limitation must be removed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, we decree freedom. We decree freedom. We decree freedom from every word of poverty in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. O God of heaven, lesatayaga, lesotosoyo, enkatafayagada, rikotopeyaga, enkatasabayagada, lesekeyenere, rindabagadabasekeyenere, likotopaya, zesekeyenelegedea. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You know, the scripture says that you and I, and all the children of God, said, we shall be the builder of old waste places and the restorer. How can you restore a building if you are poor? Hallelujah. Even though when they call upon you and say, okay, in your area, in school you went to, the building has become dilapidated and you bring money. If you don't have money, you quickly hand your number. They don't come again. You see, there is nothing good and nothing holy in poverty. He said, take care of that somewhere. Hallelujah to Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
How will you be the restorer of old waste places if you are not in command of wealth? So there is nothing holy about poverty, sir.
Only to fight with all your heart. Fight it with all your heart. Fight with all.
Detest it with everything. Detest it,
you know, for them to be known, for them to number you as a poor man.
Reject it with everything about the name of Jesus Christ. Hello?
Reject it. And we're talking about people, you know, next week we'll be talking about the purpose of that prosperity for his kingdom's sake.
There is no way God will finance his kingdom
without prosperity. How?
There is no way. There is no way. There are people who are committed and they want to go and preach the gospel in nations.
But they are being incapacitated because of money. They are being incapacitated. No money. You know, if you can go to the Swedish embassy or American embassy and say, okay, okay, I'm a Nigerian. I have the passion for the Lord. Oh, give me a visa to work for me. We're working for me to go and preach there. They bring your account.
With your anointing. With your everything,
the account is not really minimum that they should put. They will tell you, deny it. That's the truth.
So how?
And the Lord leave it. Every limitation that the enemy has set over your career, over your destiny,
it expires within the battle of Jesus.
Maybe due to racial issues, they say, okay, because you belong to certain race, because of your skin, you can't go above this level.
But as the Lord lives it, because the word of God says, because God is not a respecter of persons. No!
It doesn't have to be white to be right.
No, sir! If it is God, it is good. As the Lord lives it, everyone that is waiting for you to beg for bread will be disappointed in the matter of Jesus.
Amen!
Everyone that is waiting for you to come and borrow before you can eat, we'll be disappointed in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In this month, as we are celebrating the faithfulness of God for the release of power to get well, I see God promoting in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord God of heaven will visit you in a strange way this month in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And above everything, you will not miss heaven in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Any kind of step that you will take that will jeopardize your way, that will jeopardize you from enjoying benefit of the heaven, you will not take it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Every agent from the pit of hell that has been packaged to deceive you, to miss your way, that agent is judged for your sake in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And as you go around this week, Bible says, suffer no one to do them wrong, saying, God got my anointed and do my prophet Noah. Everyone that looks at you with evil eye will be judged in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Everyone that lay ambushment that I say he wants to bring you down, the angel of God will bring in that in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Everyone that tried to dig any pit for you to be buried, that same devil will be buried in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
I release upon you the grace for advancement in the mighty name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be your name, Lord.
Hallelujah.
In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you for listening to this message. However, I want to remind you that God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son for the entire world, including you, to be saved from sin and all its consequences. It therefore does not make any sense to spend the next minute of your life without accepting Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. God bless you as you believe and confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior right now. Hallelujah.